is solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I stand. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me. Praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
Awesome.
Well, today is All Saints' Day, a day in which we remember those who have gone before us. We remember those who have died in the faith and the hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ. And as we do, that can stir up feelings that go in different directions. And one of the directions we're going to talk about today is the day of joy, that we can actually rejoice that we're blessed in that. And so we hear in the gospel lesson today, Jesus giving the Sermon on the Mount and with the Beatitudes. He says, seeing the crowds, Jesus went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. We have every reason to rejoice, no matter the feelings that we have, for the promise of everlasting life. And so we begin this worship service this morning in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand and share the peace of the Lord with one another.
Good morning and welcome to worship. It is the call of Christ to his church to praise the Lord. Join me in response using Psalm 149. Praise the Lord.
Sing to the Lord a new song.
Praise God among the communion of saints.
Let the people of God rejoice in their Creator.
Let them praise the Lord with dance and celebrate with musical instruments.
Because the Lord delights in them and adorns the despairing with welfare.
Let all the saints jump for joy. Let them cry out with gladness where they rest.
Let high praises of God be in their throats.
Word and song that overcome injustice, binding rulers in chains and the powerful in iron shackles, bringing justice to them and honor to all God's faithful. Come, let's praise God together. Sing a new song, a song of God's goodness and mercy, faithfulness and love. For God delights in his people, crowning them with honor and glory. Let's worship together.
Awake and alive, oh Jesus, our Savior.
I looked, and there was a great crowd that no one could number. They were from every nation, tribe, people, and language. They were standing before the throne and before the Lamb, wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out with a loud voice, "Victory belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." And the angels fell face down before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen.
Call with thanksgiving all those saints who were taken from us in the church militant and carried by the angels to you in the church triumphant. We thank you for giving them new life in Christ through baptism while on this earth and for sustaining them in true and saving faith throughout their life. We praise you for giving them rest from their labors. Strengthen and sustain us this day also in that saving faith. So as we look forward to the day of resurrection when we will stand before your throne with all those that have gone before us, be with us, most gracious God, as we rejoice while mourning as those with hope in the eternal promises you give. We remember and rejoice with those who now rest with you, waiting to rise in glory. Glenn Anschutz, Randy Williams, Marge Carver, Richard Corum, Beulah Tenbrink, Carol Lay, Teresa Paulson, Charlotte Long, Cameron Meinhold, Lila Jones, Janet Kaiser, Marcine Leslie, Marvin Hosfeld, Teola Maxwell, Edwina Craver Hammersky, Willard Taylor, Jesse Wood, Betty Ramsey, Fran McCray, Chuck Urban, Don Melring. gather together today, we remember the promises that God has given to us in his word, that he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, and that as we come before him, surrounded by that great crowd of witnesses, we do so knowing his love and grace for us. And so we come to him confessing our sins and asking for his forgiveness. I invite you to join me in your hearts and minds as we come before God today. Gracious God, on this day when we remember those who rest from their labors, whose sorrow is gone, who no longer fear, we remember our own brokenness, the fears that we have, the tremblings we have, the doubts we have about your goodness, your graciousness. We look at our lives and we know all that we have done wrong, and all the things we have left undone. And yet with you, we know there's grace, we know there's forgiveness, even when our hearts tremble. Hear our prayers, Lord, our confessions, and our need for your mercy. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer and die for you and to rise again so that you can have life in his name. Know that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
O sovereign God, O matchless King, the saints adore, the angels sing. This passing tide, under your wings I will abide, and every enemy shall flee. You are my hope and victory. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, clothed in
Oh,
above every name is Jesus Christ, and at his name every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord of heaven and on earth. And because he is Lord, he has given us the greatest gift of all, his forgiveness and grace poured out in with and under body. Bread and wine are body and blood for the forgiveness of sins. It was on that night when our Lord was betrayed that he took bread. And when he gave thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them also, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. You may be seated. Martin, take and eat the true body of Christ, given for you.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world my dawn. Thank you.
Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ bless you and keep you in true faith to life everlasting. Depart in his joy and his peace. Your sins are forgiven. Let's pray. Gracious God, we do thank you that you give us of yourself, that you come to us to refresh us and restore us and renew us, that in this gift of body and blood we find grace and love and what we need for this body and life. Guide us each day to live for you, and may our ears be open, our hearts ready to receive the words that you bring to us today, in Christ in whom we pray. Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Blessed. It may not be the word that you would first come to mind on All Saints Day, but when we remember those who have gone before us, particularly those that have been close to us, who've died in Christ with the hope of eternal life, blessed may not quite seem right, because our hearts can become tender at the remembering. And yet we hear blessed 9 times in the Beatitudes that we read today. So the question is what meaning of blessed serves us in remembering the saints for growing in the faith as they did? If we look to the world and our daily lives, we probably hear blessing most often when we sneeze, right? According to the Library of Congress website, one belief is that this practice originated in Rome, apparently during the raging of the bubonic plague. I don't say that very fast. And apparently Pope Gregory decreed that anybody who sneezed should immediately, everybody around him should say immediately back, "God bless you," in order to hopefully be a blessing in case that death, certain death would come, because sneezing was apparently a common first symptom of the plague. So we hear "God bless you," but we left off "God" now. All we say is "bless you," and it's sort of a polite way of some polite saying that we do during an awkward moment. Or we might hear someone say, "I'm so blessed," when something unusually good happens, when the returns from their efforts are better than expected, or when they've successfully avoided something bad from happening to them. They're blessed. Or during Thanksgiving season, we're told to count your blessings, particularly those that we've taken for granted the rest of the year. Interesting enough, if we take all of these different situations that we're talking about, we find out that blessing means something that can depend on us saying something, on us putting ourselves in the right position, on us taking stock of what we've achieved. Well, that may be what the world regards as blessed. It's not the same when it comes to God's word. Blessed does not come from what we say, do, or think. Blessed is what we achieve. Blessed is what God does for us, what he gives us. So our epistle text that was assigned for this Sunday says this: "See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are." A father who blesses and gives, that's what a father does. And can it be any more plain? What did you do to become a child of your parents? Nothing. Not a thing you did. Your life is a blessing, entirely a gift from its very beginning. And so you're blessed because you are God's child, and you are God's child because of what Jesus has done for you and now gives you. And that's the blessedness that's being spoken of in the Beatitudes. For they tell us that our God is giving and gracious. He gives what we don't have. He gives back more than we give. He gives us what we don't deserve. And all these blessings that we have in Christ come through faith in him, given to us as children who know that our lives and all we are come from God, who know also that we're saved and redeemed by Christ, who know that our works count for nothing toward our salvation. So let's take a couple of the Beatitudes and just unpack them a little bit to confirm what I've just said. The first one: "And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, blessed is right in the middle of a highlighted it there. And in the Greek, it appears right up front, a place of emphasis. And in its context, blessed here connotes something that happens right now with more to come. A now and not yet kind of meaning. Blessed also is much more than happiness. It's much more. It's stronger. It's more significant. It's more like the word saved. Now, with that understanding of the word blessing, grab hold of it, because we're going to open it up. We're going to find out it explains everything for us. The poor in spirit. They're spiritually needy, even destitute. They're like sheep who are lost, like sinners in need of forgiveness, like beggars before God, like you and me, who have nothing in ourselves. We have no inner reserve, no spark of spiritual strength, no power tucked away or hidden away. We are destitute, in need of Jesus to open our mouths, open his mouth, that we may hear his blessing of grace. And what's Jesus saying? He's saying this: the reign of heaven belongs to you, because I paid for your sins on the cross, because I lived and died that you could be baptized into me, because I earned your forgiveness and gave you my righteousness with the hope of life everlasting. I sent you the Holy Spirit, who calls you to faith and obedience, and I will nourish your faith and strengthen you through my body and blood. And so from his very mouth, Jesus says, you are blessed, and so you are. The kingdom of heaven is yours because Jesus said it and made it possible for you. Let's take one more example from the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall or will be comforted. Why do the people mourn? We just said that the reign of heaven already began. And yet there's still sin and evil in this world, in our lives, in our church. And so we bow our heads. We mourn over the messes in our lives. And we pray for God's help. For we live in the tender tension that on one hand, we have the present blessing that Jesus is reigning in heaven and has already begun. And on the other hand, we live in the present. We mourn over sin and evil. And our comfort comes not just from what the gospel of forgiveness that is ours now, but we also have the promise of lasting comfort that on the last day there will be no more sin and evil. Jesus will come, and his mouth again will open to bless us with the complete fulfillment of the Beatitudes. But there's even more right now. The Lord is speaking to you his word of forgiveness in the absolution. His word of grace in the gospel being proclaimed. His word of New Testament in the body and blood which you just received. And through the power of all these blessings, God has a way of mysteriously uniting us with the angels and the saints across all time, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Say it with me. Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. You have just been mysteriously joined with all the saints across time, all your loved ones who died in the faith. In that very moment, you joined with them in saying the praises and singing the praises of our Lord. When you receive God's body and blood, at that very moment, you receive the same body and blood, and they were communing with the Lord too. All one, united in the mystery. One holy fellowship, one holy communion. All in praise of our Lord and Savior, receiving his blessings. But I have to ask you, are you blessed? How do you know? Yeah, with saints, we are saints who have faith in Christ. We know that we are also sinners who live in this world. And every day, by the world standards, we're told that nothing good could seem to be happening for someone who is spiritually poor or mourning. After all, if you're blessed according to the world, good things should be happening to you. Things that look good, things that everyone agrees are grand and glorious, things that prove to the world that you are blessed. And yet Jesus says later in the Sermon on the Mount that God the Father makes his Son rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. He's saying good things are going to happen to all people. Bad things are going to happen to all people. That they do is not how you judge blessedness. It's not a matter of judging by what we think or feel is good and bad, nor is it on us to explain the good or bad through the blessings that God gives us. For those participating in the congregational Bible study, this is the hiddenness about which you studied in session 4. The reality of who we are, children of God, and what we have been given in Christ are hidden in this world, hidden under the cross, hidden under suffering and pain. And that's why the Beatitudes sound like a paradox. How can you be called blessed when you're poor in the spirit, mourn, are meek, or hunger and thirst for righteousness? So back to the question. How do you know you're blessed? Because you have heard Jesus say so. And God's word tells us that Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. And from God from heaven instructed us, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. Listen to Jesus calling you blessed. Listen to Jesus saying, rejoice and be glad. Why? Because the gifts and blessings he brings have already been given to you through faith. Yours is the kingdom of heaven. Yours is the inheritance. Yours is the comfort. All yours. But for now, the full glory of this is hidden. Now, all of us know there are times when we're in the dumps, when we're weighed down, even overwhelmed, and counting blessings seems like the last thing we want to do. And that's when God's word is powerful for us. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. God's word promises we shall see him as he is. And he will appear and show us that we are his own. A story. I decided to add it to the sermon last night. It's probably good that I did. It was a little dry, I thought the sermon was. So it comes out of the first chapter of this book, Your God is Too Glorious, by Chad Bird, a theologian who I enjoy reading. He tells a story of the time when he was 14 years old. It was 4th of July, and he had a firecracker that was just stubborn. He just couldn't get it lit. And like any boy has done over the years, leans a little bit close into the firecracker, hoping to light it. As he leans in, of course, the firecracker explodes, burning off his eyebrows, his eyelashes, and coating both of his eyes with powder. Can't see a lick. His parents are terrified. They take him to one hospital, and then another. He's checked into the hospital. And he's told surgery is scheduled for the next morning for them to scrape the powder off of his eyes. His mother, a faithful believer, stays awake most of the night and prays aloud that the Lord would have mercy on her son, that he would regain his eyesight. Chad Bird awoke the next morning, and the powder was dissolved from his eyes. The surgeons came in, scratched their heads, and he was discharged 3 hours later. But listen to how he looks at that. That was 3 decades ago. Today, if you look closely at my left eye, you'll see one tiny speck of black lodged within the whiteness. It's the gunpowder of my reckless youth, a relic of the night when I first caught a glimpse of how we see through our ears, the Father's means of infiltrating our lives. It is not the unexpected healing I'm talking about. I mean that God chose to reveal himself in the midnight of a hospital room to a blinded country boy by means of his mother's prayers, in the thick of fear and pain and a gut-wrenching feeling that life as I knew it would never be the same. No one was happy. There was nothing good about that night. It was darkness, not life, grief, not joy. It was one of the longest, worst, most painful nights of my life. Yet looking back over the years, it was precisely then that I saw, through my ears, for the first time, God at work. He chose to let me see why my eyes were burned shut. He let me see him veiled in my mother's prayers, swaddled in my fears, holding me in the horrible mess of my accident, as only a father can. All of us have our own stories, big things, small things, everyday things. When God's thinly veiled voice is heard, and we know that he's working on us. Those are blessings. He's working just as he's promised, blessing us for the long haul. For we often react to our daily worries and our wishes, wanting immediate relief from them. And those wishes and desires can leave us in a fog, forgetting the fullness of what God has promised as his blessing, blessings that have not yet appeared, the fullness that will not appear until in all their glory until Jesus appears again. So All Saints Day calls us out of the fog of this world to see the truth again, to see what true blessedness is and from whom it comes. Not from us or what we think, say, or do, but from Christ alone. You are blessed with his blessedness. You, a sinner, are also a saint in Christ, holy because your sin is forgiven by what Christ has done for you and given to you, and not just you. But as John saw in his revelation, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." Yes, All Saints Day is a time for looking back into our past and seeing ourselves surrounded by that great cloud of witnesses, our grandparents, great-grandparents, great-aunts and uncles, all of those who have died in the faith. Their lives may not have always looked blessed, but by faith we can see how God was working to bless them, working in them and through them, that the faith would be passed on to each of us. And we, by faith, can rejoice that they are safely home. And the great multitude that John saw, those we remember in our hearts and whom we may terribly miss, those who glory shine. For as John said, they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Blessing and blood. Didn't know that, but they're connected. The words, and that we can trace the words back, and they have an origination of connection. That sacrifices and blood are a blessing to us. They bring us what we need. But go with this message, that Jesus is always working to bless you. He said so. He's done so. Your glorious and eternal future of blessedness awaits you. For in Christ your sins are forgiven. Your robes are washed and made white in the blood of the Lamb, in baptism, in confession and absolution, and in communion. And this is your blessing at all times, good or bad. And so we can follow Jesus' word and rejoice, not only for ourselves, but especially today. We rejoice for those who have gone before us, for we see the mercy which God showed them, and we see their faith he gave them to embrace all the blessings that he gave them. And we rejoice in the hope that we will join them one day. And when the night of sin and death will be over as the sun comes again, and what we see dimly now, we will see fully. So rejoice and be glad, for that great reward of heaven is yours, not because of what you've done, but because of what Jesus, who made you a child of God, has done for you. And you are blessed indeed. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ. Amen.
We invite our kids forward for a message for them. Good morning. How are you? Oh, good to see you. Hello. So, did any of you play in the rain this week?
No, I wish.
No, you wish you could? Well, why didn't you?
Because
you couldn't.
I didn't want to.
You didn't want to? Why not? You just didn't? No. You know what I thought about the rain this week? It was cold. It was really cold. And I was walking outside, and all of a sudden, it was just a little sprinkle, and then it started to rain really hard. Ever have that happen to you?
Yeah, school a lot.
At school a lot? What do you need when it starts raining really, really hard?
The umbrella.
Yeah, the umbrella, right? They always tell me not to open one indoors, but I'm going to anyway. It's a small room, you're right. But you know what? Why do we use umbrellas? Yeah, why do we use umbrellas? The rain or the sun or maybe even snow or other things off of us, right? Because sometimes that can be hard on us. And this protects us from rain or snow or sun, just like God protects us when things come down on us. That there's forces out there that Satan, and he's always trying to get us to go away from God or to bring badness, hard things to us, and God is always working to protect us. And he covers us, just like the umbrella covers us, with his love and his grace and his peace, and, as Pastor Martin just said, with his blessings. So when we have an umbrella, it's a reminder to us that God covers us too, that he is always giving us his blessings and covering us with his grace. And so this week, I think it may rain again. Do you think it might rain again? So if you get caught in the rain, you don't think so? Well, we'll find out. If you get caught in the rain this week,
I do.
You do? We can, you can get your umbrella out, and you can remember how God covers you also and protects you by his grace and love. Can we pray?
Thankful.
Dear God, thank you for protecting us and covering us with your grace and your love. Thank you for your blessings, which are always with us. In Christ Jesus, amen. Awesome. Thanks for coming up, guys. And as you head back to your seats, we'll invite the congregation to stand for the prayers of the church. Gracious God, we do thank you and praise you for the blessings that you give to us, that you are a God who is with us, and that our blessings are not dependent on our feelings and our thoughts, but based on what you have already given to us in Christ Jesus. Help us, Lord, to see that we are truly blessed because you have met us here and you have given us your grace. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, continue to walk with us every day. And in those moments of mourning, those moments where we miss those who have gone before us and rest in your presence, help us to rejoice, to know the blessing of your love, the blessing of your comfort, which comes to us each time and in every way through Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, for those that need you in this time and in this place, need you in ways that sometimes we're not even sure, but you bring healing and hope and comfort and forgiveness. And we ask it today for Larry and Zach, for Rose and Muriel, Roger and Idell, Brenda, Kurt, Susan, and Mary, and for all those that are suffering or in need of healing or grace according to your will, Lord, bring them your peace. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, for those that mourn, and those whose hearts are broken today especially, that they know your comfort, especially for the family of Don Melring, who is laid to rest this week, who is in your presence and knows the blessing of rest, even though we mourn now. Give all his family that comfort and that joy and the peace that we know that those who rest with you will rise in glory on that great and glorious day. Lord, in your mercy. For our country, Lord, we pray and ask for your grace as we go to the polls once again this week, that those who are running for election would do so with integrity and with honor. And may you continue to watch over this country and all the countries of the world, that our leaders would rule godly in godly ways, would seek your will and your peace, and would look to protect those under their care. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, for every prayer that we pray, for all the prayers of our hearts, all the things that we lift to you, you are a God who hears us and cares for us. You hear the groans and the cries that are too deep for words. And in the moments we need those words that we cannot find, you have given us ones to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Having heard God's word and knowing that faith comes through it, we confess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Go and have a seat. And again, welcome and a blessed day of where we celebrate All Saints. I know that this brings up memories for many people. It brings up thoughts and comfort and sometimes even hardship. And so if you are mourning this day, know that God has blessed you with his grace upon grace. And that's the message we heard, the message we cling to and hold to every day, but especially on a day like this. There's lots of things going on around here today. Just want to remind you that going on today, right after this service, you can head downstairs for the LWML Noodle Dinner. They've been busy preparing. It smells great in here. It's time to eat, and we're glad for that. So we hope you'll go downstairs. It's a great fundraiser, a great way to support our women and the Lutheran Women's Missionary League, what they do for us. So join us for that today downstairs. Also, next week, during the service, we're going to have several guests. It's actually TLS Sunday, so we'll have our TLS families here. We'll also have some Japanese exchange students from Washburn University who will be with us as well. And so we're inviting the congregation to join us afterward downstairs for a chance to hear from those students, to learn a little bit about their culture, but also to share your love of Jesus Christ as well with them. So we invite you to do that next Sunday downstairs in the fellowship hall after the service. Then the following Sunday the 20th, is our semi-annual voters meeting, or November voters meeting. Is always the one where we vote on the budget, approve the budget for the coming year for 2023. So we encourage you, invite you to come join us for that. Well, if you're wondering if you should, we're always going to provide a light lunch. So we'll feed you this week, we'll feed you next week, and then we'll feed you the week after, and you just keep coming back, right? So we hope you'll join us for that. It's a great opportunity also to be about the business of the church. We also have election of officers that day and members of our lay leadership council, so we hope you'll join us then. Lots of other things going on, lots of things happening around us, but as we go this day, we know the blessing of God because we have met him here, he has given us his gifts, and so we go out to worship him. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, giving you always his peace. Amen. While you stand up, I'm going to get hooked up. Share Christ's love.
Thanks be to God.
God's richest blessings on your week.